All right, let's restart our discussion. An extremely interesting point here. So this is a penetration length. If I have a finite barrier and the energy is smaller than the potential change, so this is the classically forbidden region, and the wave function can still penetrate into this classically forbidden region. Now, an experimenter might ask you the question, okay, if there is a finite wave function here, then you might be able to find the particle here. So you might be able to find the particle in the classically forbidden region. But the problem with this is that if you were to find the probability of locating the particle within this narrow region, then you're actually confining the particle within the length scale of delta. And if you confine the particle within the length scale of delta, uncertainty principle comes and hits you. Because you have delta E multiplied, or delta P multiplied with the uncertainty in position, which is now delta. This has to be greater than h bar, for example. Right? This is the uncertainty principle. So now you're confining the particle to within a small region, delta. So this relationship has to hold true, which means that my delta P, which is the uncertainty in momentum, is greater than h bar over the penetration length. But my penetration length is h bar 2m v naught minus e under root. So this h bar goes away. So my uncertainty in momentum is lower bounded. It has to be greater than a certain amount. So my momentum, P, has to be greater than the uncertainty in momentum. Suppose you were in an amusement park and there's a joyride and there's a meter stick that tells you that every child who's above this, above 500 centimeters or above 75 centimeters in height is allowed to go on to the joyride. Now if your scale is uncertain by 100 centimeters, then there's no chance of actually measuring or allowing children below a certain height to go on joyride. So your scale has to be precise. If this is the uncertainty in the scale, then your momentum has to be larger than this uncertainty. So this P has to be larger than delta P. So P has to be larger than 2m V naught minus E. So if P is larger than this, then my energy has to be larger than this. It has to be larger than P squared over 2m. Which means that my energy has to be larger. The uncertainty in energy is larger than V naught minus E. So if my energy is larger than this gap over here, this is V naught minus E, then the particle which is confined within this narrow region has an energy that is bigger than this gap, which means that it's difficult to confine the particle inside this region. So even though the wave function does exist, if you make an attempt to actually find out the particle inside this region, it's not going to work. Uncertainty principle is going to prevent you. It's going to come and hit you back. Yes? There is no concept of wavelength or the wave function after the barrier, because it's not an oscillatory function. If the function is oscillatory, if it's of this form, then you have a concept of wavelength, but there's no wavelength here. Yes? No, what I'm trying to prove here is that if my energy is smaller than the potential gap, the wave function penetrates or leaks into the classically forbidden region. Now, if there is a finite wave function here, I might ask the question, okay, let's find out the particle. Let's try to locate the particle inside this region. But if you attempt to do that, the uncertainty principle comes and hits you, because then the minimum energy is greater than actually this gap here, which means that the particle will fly away. It does not like to be confined inside this particle. It's just like pushing an electron close to the nucleus. If you push the electron closer and closer to the nucleus, you're confining it, its energy is going to go up. Okay? If its energy is going to go up, it's going to fly away. It's going to resist confinement. You trap it to a smaller and smaller region, the energy scales are going to go up, the energy of the particle is going to prevent you from locating the particle within that confined region. That's why even though the wave function is finite here, it will defy, uncertainty principle will defy all attempts to actually locating it. So the quantum mechanical principles, they are beautiful and they are restrictive at the same time. They give you a certain probability, but then they hold you back. And the reason is, why do we have this wave function inside this classically forbidden region? So there are two points. We have a wave function because h bar is non-zero. This penetration exists. This is not zero because h bar is not zero. If h bar were zero, if you lived in a world where the Planck's constant were zero, you will not see any quantum effect. There will be no penetration inside this region. All of the particle is going to be reflected back as in the classical world. So h bar is non-zero, it is finite. So this gives you some probability or some wave function leading into this classical forbidden region. But the other thing is that this h bar is really, 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 really small. Since it's so small, it's difficult to observe this penetration. This is small, yet non-zero, which makes this small, yet non-zero. And since this is small, the uncertainty principle comes and hits you and makes the energies really large if you try to locate the particle inside that region. So this smallness of h, but finitude of h, this non-zeroness of h, is both of these effects are working at the same time. H naught is non-zero, that's why you have quantum mechanics, and h naught is small, that's why it's so difficult to see quantum mechanics. Okay, let me repeat. H bar is small, that's why it's difficult to see quantum mechanics, but H bar is non-zero, that's why there is quantum mechanics. Now, if there's no chance of locating the particle in this forbidden region, how do I know that this is even true? This is just mathematical damage. I know it's true because if I make a potential barrier of this kind, there's a step, but the step is of finite width. So it goes up and comes down again. So there's a blip. So I have a potential landscape of this kind. If I had a potential landscape of this kind, and if I solve the Schrodinger equation, and I'm going to give this problem as a homework, I have a certain wave function here. A certain k here, an oscillating function, that's the solution of the Schrodinger equation in this free region. Particle is acting like a free particle, and it's being issued from the left, and it's hitting this barrier, coming from the left, the barrier is to its right. Here there is decay, because the energy of the particle is smaller than the gap. This is the energy of the particle. It's smaller than this step. So there is decay here. Okay? There's no oscillation inside, there's no wave here, but there's some penetration. Now this distance is d, which is the width of this barrier, d. And there is a certain penetration length, delta, which tells you how fast this wave function is decaying in space. And on the other side of the potential barrier, once again there's a change of interface. This potential energy is going down now. And here the particle is once again acting like a free vagabond, a free particle. So it acts like a free particle, it again assumes an oscillatory mode, and it has a certain wavelength. This wavelength, or k, is the same as this k, because the gap between the energy and V0 is the same in this region. as it is in this region. The heights could be different. The amplitudes could be different. For that, we need to solve the Schrodinger equation. Okay? So there's some... Okay, if I were to write the wave functions, just without recourse to complicated mathematics, you can immediately write the wave functions. In this region, the wave function is A, E, I, K, X, plus V, E, minus I, K, X. In this, within the potential obstacle, the wave function is C, E, minus, there's no iota now, minus alpha, some alpha X. There's no iota. Now there's also a D term. There's no oscillation, but there's a D term here as well, because previously we ignored this D term because when X goes up, we don't want this wave function to explode. We don't want it to go exponentially large. But the X is finite here. It's not infinite. So we can have this term. In this regime, again, we have E, some E, E, I, K, X. But now we don't have a backward propagating wave inside this region. So these are our starting trial solutions to the Schrodinger equation. And we put the continuity relationship at X equals 0, X equals D, you can find the ratios of A, B, C, D, and E. And we can find out what is this E modulus squared versus this A modulus squared. That will tell you the probability that this particle has actually tunneled through this barrier. This phenomenon is quantum mechanical tunneling. That a particle sees a well, sees a barrier, it does not have enough classical energy to surmount the barrier. Yet there is a finite probability that this particle can leap through the potential barrier and be found on the other side. Now you can do a probability density measurement here. You can be an experimenter and find out a finite probability of locating the particle inside this region. Even though classically there's no chance of locating the particle here. Yes?
Is there a probability of the particle inside the barrier?
You cannot talk about reflection and transmission here because it's not a wave. Yes? No, this E is not going to be the same as this A. That is determined by continuity. At the back, any questions at the back? You're quite busy discussing some important physics. Any questions? Yes? Why do we have a D? That's the question?
Yes, Vadana.
Yes,
after the barrier.
Yes, can the well.
How can we have a D if you're saying we can't have reflection or transmission?
So this doesn't show reflection. This is, when you solve the Schrodinger equation for E less than V naught, you get two roots. One is plus iota alpha, you multiply that with the iota itself, you get minus alpha, and then you get this term. So you get two roots in the characteristic equation. One corresponds to plus alpha, the other corresponds to minus alpha. This is not reflection. Yes?
So why do we get alpha rather than k?
Please look up my previous lectures. Sorry if I just spend my time on these points over and over again. It's going to take away important lecture time. So please look up my previous lectures. Yes? This D? The question is, my tunneling probability, E. I define my tunneling probability as how much flux do I see on the other side of the barrier versus how much flux is coming in. That's my definition of the tunneling probability. And this is given, if I were to use these wave functions, this is given by E modulus squared over A modulus squared. Now this will depend upon certain parameters. The question is, commonsensically, or thinking in a quantum mechanical fashion, which is now our new common sense, what should this E depend upon? Please raise your hands. What should t depend upon? Yes. All right. So the first factor that comes to mind is that this t depends upon this d. If I increase small d, what's going to happen to capital T? It's going to go down. So bigger this gap or barrier, or wider this barrier, T is going to go down. T goes down. The reason is that the penetration length is fixed. That's fixed by V naught minus E. Now nothing is changing here. V naught is fixed, E is fixed. The penetration length is fixed. So the wave function is decaying inside this field. Now if I increase the length of the barrier, the decay is still small, but the barrier has gone wider. So it means that the wave function has decayed to zero before it can actually be found on the other side. Let me draw this. Alright, so now I'm increasing D. D, small d is going up from top to bottom. In this case, I have a wave function and this decays. But this width is smaller than the penetration length. So still, some wave function survives on the other end. And then I get a finite probability here. Now the decay of the wave function is, suppose this is the decay of the wave function. This is my zero axis of the wave function plot. Now the wave function is decaying in the same manner in all curves. The wave function is decaying in the same manner because the penetration length is the same. But this d is going up. So in this scenario, the wave function has actually decayed to zero. So there is zero probability of locating the, or very minuscule probability density of locating the particle inside this region, because the penetration length is small as compared to the width of the barrier. The barrier is actually so large that even though the wave function does exist, but it decays rapidly, and there is very little chance that the wave function survives on this other end. So if I increase d, the tunneling probability goes down. So tunneling is actually quantum mechanical leakage of the wave function. So if I want to see tunneling at work, I actually have to have very small d, very narrow, very thin barriers of the order of nanometers or angstroms, because my thickness of d should be comparable with the penetration length. And the penetration length is actually given by this. A bar is so small that my barriers have to be minuscule small. I don't see quantum mechanical tunneling in my real life because it's hard to make a potential step that is of the order of nanometers or angstroms. But you can make these devices and actually quantum mechanical tunneling is at play, describes a lot of natural phenomena as I'm going to describe. But it's really hard to see quantum mechanical tunneling. The second factor, so the first factor is D. What's the second factor that can determine or affect capital D? Yes. Exactly. How large is V naught compared to E? If V naught is really large, the tunneling probability is going to go down. Make sense? If capital E is small as compared to V naught, the tunneling probability is going to go down. And this barrier looks more and more like an insurmountable barrier. If this energy barrier is large, quantum mechanics struggles to make its presence felt. It becomes more like the classical world. So there are two factors on which capital T, the tunneling probability, depends. One of them is the energy as compared to V naught, or V naught as compared to the energy, and the second is the width of the barrier. Both of these determine the amount or extent of tunneling. Yes, there was a question. No, this is the energy. Energy. Now let's look at some practical applications of the quantum mechanical tunneling. Yes. So this is my V naught, and this is my energy, E. Okay? I have a certain penetration at delta. If this is my E goes down, which means the energy of the incoming particle is lower as compared to V naught. V naught is not changing. Then V naught minus E goes large. When this goes large, this is the denominator, the penetration length goes down. So the wave function for this decays more rapidly in this yellow case. And there's little chance that some perceptible wave function is going to leak over into the forbidden region here. Alright, so it does depend upon E. Alternatively, you can actually increase this potential step. If I were to increase this potential step, still I didn't get the same effect. So tunneling does depend upon the barrier fit, and it depends upon the energies. Now let's look at a few examples. The most vivid example that comes to my mind is a device that gave the 1986 Nobel Prize to two IBM scientists, Benning and Rohrer, and that device is called the scanning tunneling microscope. Now, how does this device work? So this is a man-made device. But there are natural effects that depend upon tunneling as well. One of them is radioactivity. But let's talk about this device. Thank you.
Alright.
So this is a really simplistic illustration of an STM, scanning tunneling microscope. Here you have a tip, a stylus. So scanning tunneling microscopy is just like a blind person trying to read Braille. Now this is the analogy. What's happening here is you have a tip, a metal tip, or a stylus. Whose tip is atomically thin. It's really a pointed tip. Really pointed. So that this tip is of the order of a nanometer to angstroms. This tip width. Okay, so it's a fine tip that has been made somehow, generally by electrochemical means, by etching. This is a tip, specially engineered tip. Fine tip. And this is on top of a surface of a metal, of a conducting metal, of a conducting polymer or a metal or a semiconductor, something that is conducting, that has free electrons available, that can conduct it. And these are atoms on the surface of the top layer. I'm just diagrammatically showing these atoms in a cartoon fashion. Now what's happening is that this tip is connected to a battery, a voltage source, and the other end is connected to the metal surface. This is our specimen that we like to image. We have a microscope. So we're imaging something. Now, since this is air or vacuum and a current cannot flow through air or vacuum, there's an insulator, there's a barrier. Now this is a variable voltage supply. I can change this voltage. Now, if the voltage is zero, then classically there is no possibility of current flowing through the metal plate and the surface. And if I were to draw an energy landscape or a potential energy diagram, when this V, let's call this V naught, or let's call it V, let's call it U, it's a voltage. Okay? It's U is a voltage. When U equals zero, then if I were to draw the potential landscape, the electron inside the metal tip has some energy. There's a potential energy, and then there's a barrier of width d. This d is actually this separation. This is the width of the barrier, of the insulating barrier. And then we have a metal again. And this metal suppose is identical to the metal of the tip. So the potential energy is the same on the other side of the tip. Let me finish. Now you have this potential landscape. An electron is on the tip. It has some energy. So that energy could be somewhere lying somewhere here. Okay? So this is the potential landscape and this is the energy of the electron. So an electron on the tip can actually cross this barrier by quantum mechanical tunneling. So an electron on this tip can hop off from the tip and tunnel through this barrier and go on to the metal. And then if there is a tunneling current, which means that the electrons are hopping off from this barrier, then you can have current flowing through this circuit. And now I'm denoting these arrows, denote the direction of flow of the electrons, not the conventional current. But this tunneling current can actually register on an ammeter. Now this is a very sensitive ammeter because this current is going to be really small. That's why I put an N here. N stands for a nano. Something small, something that is capable of making small currents. Actually, you convert this small current into a voltage by an amplifier. But nevertheless, this is some device capable of measuring this small tunneling current. Now, if this separation is large, which means D is large, then there is no chance of tunneling. Because your tunneling current, which is now proportional to this coefficient t, is sensitively dependent upon d. If you make d large, then the tunneling current fades to zero. It's imperceptibly small. It's within the noise regime of this nanometer, you'll never see it. But if this tip is sufficiently close to the metal, then there is some chance of seeing tunneling. Now if I increase this potential, what I'm actually doing is I'm changing this potential landscape. I'm increasing the possibility of tunneling. And how is this potential landscape dependent upon U? I know that if I have a potential U, a voltage U, and I have a charge E, then the potential energy of that charge is given by U times E. Right? Potential drop multiplied by the charge. That gives you the potential energy. Okay? Okay. Now what's happening is that I increase this U, or I increase the potential, this energy is going to change. This potential energy landscape is going to change. For example, this potential energy is going to change in this fashion. It's going to slow. Okay? And now, this, why does this slow? This comes out from electricity and magnetism, that if you have an electric field, then this electric field is minus the derivative of the potential energy. And we need to charge here as well. Okay? So if this is constant, if the electric field is constant here, then this V should depend upon distance in a linear fashion. Okay? Because then, if this is constant, then the V, which is the integral of this, must depend upon X. That's where you get this linear dependence upon X. But it's not important to remember this. The only thing to remember is that the application of a potential difference makes this potential sloping. Now, when this is sloping, and my energy is still here, I still have little chances of tunneling. However, if my potential energy is sloping in a more abrupt fashion, in a sharper fashion, so I'm increasing you. So when I increase U further, this slope goes sharper. Now the energy is here. Now instead of seeing a constant potential across this width, this electron is actually, there's a higher likelihood of tunneling because the energy that this, the potential value that this electron has to surmount is now of a smaller width. Because the slope has gone sharper. The effective D has gone down, which means that the tunneling current suddenly, abruptly changes. So by increasing this potential here, which means by turning on, ramping up the voltage on the battery, there is a higher likelihood that tunneling is going to take place. Now this tunneling sensitively depends upon this D, and it depends upon this battery potential. All right. So what I do, how do I do microscopy? I take this tip and keep this current constant. Now if this tip is here, there is some value of tunneling current. As the tip moves on the x direction, there's a depression on the surface of the solid. D goes up. When D goes up, the tunneling current goes down. And it sensitively goes down because the tunneling current is sensitively dependent upon D. and it's sensitively dependent upon this U. So then what I do is, in order to keep the tunneling current constant, I move the tip down. Or I increase this potential. Whatever I do, suppose I move the tip down so that the distance remains constant. Now, by how much do I move this tip down depends upon the contour of the surface. Because I would like to keep this D constant. Because this D is affecting this tunneling current, which is sensitively dependent upon this D, and it depends upon this V. Now if I move the tip further ahead, the solid is further down. This tunneling current suddenly drops. Now I want to keep it constant. I have set it, latched it onto a certain value. When I latch it onto a certain value, I will have to keep my tip, lower my tip even further. When I lower my tip even further, I make it go down by a certain amount so that this tunneling current remains constant. So that's how I scan the surface of this solid. I keep the tunneling current constant. I have tuned it or set it, latched it onto a certain value at a certain reasonable range of tunneling current. So I can scan the entire surface, and the amount by which I move the tip up and down sensitively depends upon the surface. So I'm actually imaging the surface. And now what I have is a few slides and a movie for you. You have class in 5 minutes?
Yes.
Okay. So this pictures that you've seen, iron atoms have been taken on a copper surface and they have been placed on a triangle, on a square, on a coral. And these ripples that you see on the surface are actually probability density functions of electrons. So with the help of an STM, you are actually finding out the density of electrons. How many electrons are available at a certain surface? So this is quantum mechanics being pictured. You are actually seeing the probability density. You see these ripples over here? These are called quantum corals. These are probability density function diagrams that you can actually see with an STM. And what I would like to show you is the world's smallest movie manipulated with an STM. This is an actual movie. So these are actually atoms being manipulated by the scanning current microscope. And these atoms have been placed by an STM. And these are probability density functions of electrons. You can see these contours and ripples on the surface of the substrate. Look, see here. All right, thank you very much.